debate on the general principles of a bill for an act to provide the framework for handling unclaimed financial assets to establish the Unclaimed Financial Assets Agency and the Unclaimed Financial Assets Trust Fund, and for other matters connected thereto. Honorable members will recall that the bill was read the first time on Wednesday, 16 March 2016. And now I invite Honorable Abdulrahman Shuaibu Abubakar to move that the bill be now read a second time. Honorable Shuaibu, please.
Shuaibu, representing Mubi North, Mubi South, and Maiha Federal Constituency of Adamawa State. With the kind permission of Mr. Speaker and honorable colleagues, I move that a bill for an act to provide the framework for handling unclaimed financial assets to establish the Unclaimed Financial Assets Agency and the Unclaimed Financial Assets Trust Fund, and for other matters connected thereto, be read the second time. I so move, Mr. Speaker.
Arise to second this, that this bill be read the second time. So important, because so many assets on claim dividends are lying fallow in these very various companies. It is a very important bill. I so second.
Mr. Speaker, the unclaimed financial assets in Nigeria have been on the rise, as most Nigerians continue to invest in stock, banks, insurance companies, pension fund managers, etc., which many at times fail to reunify the assets with the owners and beneficiaries whenever challenges arise. Most of the people, in particular the bereaved, find themselves bewildered, especially after being deceased by their breadwinners. This is because they rarely trace most of the financial assets owned by these individuals due to the scanty information and lack of an effective reunification system in the country. The situation has continued unabated as a result of lack of proper legislative framework or established policy and procedure for the management of unclaimed property. This is essentially the purpose of this bill, Mr. Speaker. It has a lot of benefits, Mr. Speaker. The bill seeks to provide legislative framework for dealing with unclaimed financial assets due to the colossal sums of money represented by unclaimed assets held by financial and other institutions in Nigeria. The need for such legislative framework has been demonstrated by the billions of naira of unclaimed assets in the country. By definition, Mr. Speaker, unclaimed asset is a financial asset that has had no owner-generated activity for a defined period of time. These include collapsed pyramid schemes, abandoned or dormant bank accounts and insurance policy benefits, unclaimed pension entitlements, bail and bond monies, lotteries and prize monies, unclaimed dividends, abandoned safe deposit box contents. The current international best practice for managing unclaimed financial assets, including the management of information related to such assets, is the establishment of a mandatory legal and regulatory framework. This typically entails the mandatory identification of unclaimed financial assets, reporting,
order,
and remittance of such assets into a central reclaim fund, and the establishment of unclaimed assets agency to regulate and manage these assets. The current situation in Nigeria contrasts sharply with the best international practice. It is estimated that unclaimed financial assets in the financial system, the corporate sector, and other institutions, including utilities, may exceed 200 billion of naira. Of this estimate, about 90% or more of these unclaimed assets may never be reunited with their owners or beneficiaries for reasons that include passage of time, death of owners, missing records, change of address, and so many other things. The current framework in Nigeria does not provide for a system of mandatory notification, because there is no law. So those that are holding these unclaimed assets are not compelled to report or put notifications or reminders to potential unclaimed financial assets owners, nor disclose or publicize unclaimed financial assets.
Order. Honourable Member, let Mr. Speaker listen to this debate.
Implementing effective reunification system will help protect the interests of potential unclaimed financial asset owners, particularly the most vulnerable owners and beneficiaries, such as widows, orphans, dependents, and others who are less financially literate. It is important to note that the proposed bill makes it mandatory for holding institutions to report on progress of reunification while the assets are in their custody and disclosing the residual value. It further embeds a perpetual right of reclaim and reunification as a core function of a new legal regime, thereby passing the status of limitation of actions. An unclaimed financial asset regime will assist the financial system to minimize fraud by employees of holding institutions, corporate malpractice by holding institutions, and promote sound corporate social responsibility through reunification services. It will also raise standards of corporate governance through increasing transparency and accountability in the management of third-party assets. The bill proposes the establishment of unclaimed financial assets agency, the creation of a trust fund. The rationale behind this is to separate and ring-fence the fund from politicians and bureaucrats. Further, the bill taxes the trust fund with making unclaimed assets data on owners public via a searchable database, giving all possible and genuine claimants an equal right and opportunity to the information. The bill comes in six parts, a schedule and an explanatory memorandum. Part one contains the preliminary provisions. Part two contains wide-ranging provisions and general principles relating to the unclaimed financial assets. These provisions relate to the period of time, the expiry of which unclaimed assets shall be deemed to have been abandoned. In particular, it provides for how travelers' checks and money orders, which remain unclaimed for 2 years or more from the date of issue, are to be dealt with. It provides that a deposit paid to a utility firm for the provision of service and which remains unclaimed for 2 years or more from the date of termination of service shall be deemed to have been abandoned. Part two also provides that any payment made pursuant to a court order which remains unclaimed for more than 2 years from the date of the order shall be deemed to have been abandoned. Part three provides for the manner in which unclaimed financial assets are to be dealt with and the duties incumbent upon holders of unclaimed assets. In particular, a duty is imposed on such a holder of unclaimed financial asset to make reasonable effort to locate the owner of the unclaimed asset and notify such owner accordingly of the existence of the asset. Similarly, the holder of unclaimed assets, which are presumed to be abandoned, is placed under an obligation to compile a report setting out various details pertaining to the asset and submit the same to the unclaimed financial assets authority. The authority is also empowered under this part to ask for information from the holder of unclaimed assets, which are deemed to have been abandoned. A person filing a report under this part is obliged to deliver the unclaimed asset to the authority at the time of making the report, and the authority is thereby required to take custody of the unclaimed asset. Under this part, the authority is also empowered to sell unclaimed assets in its custody upon expiry of 3 years from the time it took custody of the asset by way of public auction. Similarly, a person claiming an interest in unclaimed asset in the custody of the authority is allowed to lodge a claim with the authority, and if the claim succeeds, the authority is required to deliver the asset, the subject of the claim, to the claimant. A person who is aggrieved by the decision of the authority or whose claim is not determined by the authority may seek recourse in a court of law. The authority is required to maintain a database of all the unclaimed assets vested on it under the bill. Part 4 provides for the establishment, powers, and functions of the Unclaimed Financial Assets Authority. The authority is established as a body corporate, and its management is to be vested on a board whose composition is set out in this part. Similarly, the subject, the objects, and functions of the authority are set out in this part. Part 5 provides for the establishment of the Unclaimed Financial Assets Trust Fund, which is to be administered by the authority. There is to be paid into the fund unclaimed assets, which vest in the authority under the bill, and the monies realized from the sale of such unclaimed assets by the authority claims for unclaimed assets approved by the authority are to be paid from the fund, together with the monies to defray the cost of administration of the authority. Part 5, Mr. Speaker, contains miscellaneous provisions. It, among other things, set out offences under the bill and the attendant penalties. It also empowers the minister to make regulations under the bill on the recommendation of the board of the authority. The bill contains one schedule which deals with supplementary provisions relating to the governing board and an explanatory memorandum. In conclusion, Mr. Speaker, by enacting this bill, this legislation, Nigeria will be conforming to international best practice in handling of third-party monies by institutions that exercise fiduciary responsibilities, joining the ranks of Kenya, Malaysia, Ireland, Canada, and the United States. I therefore urge our honorable members to support this bill, though I'm very sure that when it comes to public hearing, some of the stakeholders who are beneficiaries of these unclaimed assets may not be happy with it. But I believe the legislature will stand by its actions and pass this bill so that we can protect the interests of Nigeria and Nigerians. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I so submit.
Those against, say nay. Ayes have it. Clerk is invited to read the long title of the bill.
Financial Assets, to establish the Unclaimed Financial Assets Agency and the Unclaimed Financial Assets Trust Fund, and for other matters connected thereto. Second reading.
The sixth order of the day, honorable colleagues, commencement of debate on the general principles of a bill for an act to establish the National Poverty Alleviation and Eradication Commission of Nigeria and for other related matters. Honorable members recall the bill was read the first time on Wednesday, 16 March 2016. I now invite Honorable Abdulrahman Shuaib Abubakar to move that the bill be now read a second time.
Move north, move south, might have federal constituency of Adamawa State. With the kind permission of Mr. Speaker and honorable colleagues, I move that a bill for an act to establish the National Poverty Alleviation and Eradication Commission of Nigeria and for other related matters be read the second time. I so move, Mr. Speaker.
Arise to second the motion to move the bill by my colleague, Honorable Shuaib. I so second.
The bills seeks to establish the National Poverty Alleviation and Eradication Commission for purposes of focusing on provision of strategies for the eradication of absolute poverty in Nigeria and to coordinate the poverty reduction related activities of all relevant ministries, parastatals and agencies. We know that there are different parastatals and agencies of government have different programs on poverty alleviation, but these programs are not properly coordinated. So that's why the purpose of this bill is to give legal backing and to provide the legislative framework for the coordination and implementation of a poverty alleviation program, scheme and strategies in Nigeria. Fundamentally, you know, we used to have NAPEP. NAPEP was scrapped because it didn't have any legal backing. And NAPEP was not very effective because it was not coordinating all the other agencies of government. But this bill seeks to bring in all other agencies of government that have to do with poverty alleviation so that they can be centrally coordinated so that we can get a very sustainable result and improvement. So the benefit is of the bill is to focus on provision of strategies for eradication of absolute poverty in Nigeria and to coordinate and monitor all poverty reduction related activities of all relevant ministries, parastatals and agencies to ensure that the wide range of activities are centrally planned, coordinated and complement one another so that the objective of policy continuity and sustainability are achieved. It will also ensure the economic and empowered independence of all Nigerians through being employable, self-employment and better sustainable family livelihood. To coordinate, monitor and oversee poverty eradication by various organizations operating in Nigeria. Develop strategies and sectoral policies and assist the key sector ministries responsible for basic economic and social services to define and implement their own poverty reduction targets. Conduct strategic discussions with planned partners and implementing national agencies. undertake demonstration poverty reduction operations in various states and set standards on poverty reduction dimension, dissemination with government ministries and other national agencies. Initiate poverty forum at national, state and local government levels to monitor plan implementation and promotion coordination to perform such other functions as may be necessary. Then the bill comprises of section 1 to 30 with a schedule and explanatory memorandum. Sections 1 to 12 provides for the establishment of the commission, the governing board, composition, tenure of office, removal, cessation, functions, structure, appointment of director general, secretary and other staff of the commission. Sections 13 to 21 provides for funds, finance and other related provisions. Sections 22 to 30 provides for miscellaneous provisions. The schedule of the bill deals with supplementary provisions relating to the governing board and an explanatory memorandum. Honorable colleagues, Mr. Speaker, honorable colleagues, by enacting the poverty, the National Poverty Alleviation and Eradication Commission, the ideal of setting up NAPEP in 2015 in the first place will be achieved, and also it will be an improvement because it will be better coordinated now than it was before. So I therefore humbly urge you to support this bill, which I believe will greatly help in bringing about development in our great nation. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, honorable colleagues. I so submit.
I'm from Adamawa State. Mr. Speaker, I've brought similar bill before that has already been committed to the Committee of the on Poverty Alleviation to establish a commission on Poverty Alleviation and Eradication Commission. There was a bill already, similar bill, that has already been committed to the Committee on Poverty Alleviation. So just to guide the House, I don't know if we can still pass this one so that two of them can go through the public hearing.
Chairman. My dear colleagues, I'm from Benue State. Mr. Speaker, like he said, his bill, you know, came on and was committed to second reading before Honorable Goni brought his own. And by our rules, it is only if it's in the same session that you cannot bring such bill again for second reading. We are already in our second session, and so technically the rules do not bar this bill from coming on the floor of the House at least. That's our position.
Motion say aye. Those against it say nay. The ayes have it. Clerk is invited to read the long title of the bill.
Act provides for a national empowerment and enhancement scheme to strengthen government's drive towards alleviating poverty in Nigeria and other related matters. Second reading.
The day is commencement of debate on the general principle of a bill for an act to establish the Fisheries Society of Nigeria, charged with the responsibility for registration and discipline of members of the profession and other related matters. Honorable members will recall that the bill was read the first time on Wednesday, 20 January 2016, and I invite Honorable Abubakar Abdulrahman to move that the bill be now read a second time. Honorable Abdulrahman.
Mubi North, Mubi South, and Maiha Federal Constituency. I'm from Adamawa State. With the kind permission of Mr. Speaker and honorable colleagues, may I move that a bill for an act to establish the Fisheries Society of Nigeria, charged with the responsibility for registration and discipline of members of the profession and for other related matters, be read the second time. I so move, Mr. Speaker. Honorable colleagues, I still remain Abdulrahman Shaibu, representing Mubi North, Mubi South, and Maiha Federal Constituency. I'm from Adamawa State. Mr. Speaker, this bill seeks to establish the Fisheries Society of Nigeria, charged with the responsibility of determining the level of education needed before a person can become a member of the society. Let me emphasize, a member of the society. It further seeks to establish the governing and other organs of the society, which shall handle the responsibility of managing and setting standards of education required, and in particular seeks to protect productivity, through the instrumentality and enforcement of professional code and ethics. Mr. Speaker, we know many of the professions, like an accountant, after reading the accountancy in the university, you can go and do a professional course, become a chartered accountant. An engineer can go and become a fellow of the Institute of Society of Engineers and others. But people that go to read fisheries in the university, they don't professionalize. Those in the agri sector, other part of agri engineering, they have that opportunity of becoming professional engineers.
Engineer Solomon.
Those in the fisheries sector, they don't have any way of professionalizing themselves. So that's why this society is already existing as an NGO, but they want it to be so recognized by law so that they can practice their profession and so that they can set standards. So it is just the objectives, Mr. Speaker, honorable colleagues, is to promote the professional and practitioner development of all categories of stakeholders involved in aquaculture, capture fisheries, and post-harvest management subsector of operations, as well as fisheries research and development in Nigeria. It is also to promote the necessary forum for productive interaction of individuals and corporate stakeholders involved in fisheries, to collaborate with other organizations having related interests both in Nigeria and elsewhere globally, and to promote and support multi-variety reviews and capacity building schedules for all categories of stakeholders as a basis for assuring the relevant certification, accreditation, and endorsement schedules for all fisheries programs, projects, production centers, and facilities in the fisheries sector in Nigeria. So it is a very straightforward bill. There are just a group of people, they are not going to use public funds. It's their own, from their own subscription that they will get their funding. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I so submit, and I hope everybody will support this bill so that it can go to the committee for further legislative action. Thank you.
Keita has captured this, that they've now discovered that the protein in fish is better than the protein in cattle. So Keita, a full animal, too, has answered that question. Your Excellency, Honorable Philip Shuaibu.
I remain Comrade Shuaibu Philip, representing the people of Issako West, Issako East, and Issako Central. I want to join my brother, my namesake, that supporting the motion and the bill. Mr. Speaker, I think we are talking about standardization, and the bill is... Mr. Speaker, I think we are talking about standardization. The bill seeks to correct many things, more so that our country is going localized. We are talking about local content. And if we are going to local content and want to turn Nigeria to an exporting nation, obviously the issue of standard will come. And this body, if set up, will assist to have all our products being standardized. But the problem will be also the locals. We hope that the bill also will not get to a level where the locals, especially from South, will not start having problems, because majority of us there may not have gone through primary or secondary school, but our major source of livelihood is the fish because of the proximity of the water. But what the bill seeks to correct or to bring in, which I support, is that the issue of standard will come in because professionalism has to do with standard. And people are aware that sanctions are there when certain things are done. Because I remember when I was small, people go to the river and put Gamali 20 inside there just to catch fish. Issues like that will not occur again when there are standardization and professionalism in terms of this profession. So I want to support, I want to urge the House to support it, because it's timely and our nation is more localized. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much, honorable members. The question is that the bill be now read the second time to read the long title of the bill.
Honorable Speaker, honorable members, a bill for an act to establish the Fisheries Society of Nigeria, charged with the responsibility for registration and discipline of members of the profession and for other related matters. Second reading.
Bill referred to the Committee on Agricultural Production and Services.
Honorable Rahman Shuaibu Abubakar Talba Mudi, Mubi.
This is Abdulrahman Shuaibu representing Mubi North, Mubi South.
Order, honorable members, please.
I'm from Adamawa State. Mr. Speaker, I come under Order 8, Rule 4, matter of urgent public importance. And
yes, please
suspend our rules under Order 8, Rule 7. We should suspend.
Honorable Arabo.
So that we can take it.
Arabo, please go back.
We can take it now. The matter is on the need for the government
go
to take immediate
to
action on the reported malnutrition in the internally displaced persons camp in Burma and other areas recaptured from insurgency. I so move, Mr. Speaker.
Speaker, colleagues, my name is Honorable Dixon. I rise to second the motion that we set aside our relevant rules so that this motion can be taken as a matter of...
Thanks. It's a name. Any seconder to...
My name is Abdulrazak. I represent Genye Jada Tongoma. I rise to second that all our... to enable Honorable... I so second.
Before we move the motion, Honorable Sani Zoro has a motion on almost the same subject matter.
Honorable Mustafa, as a consequence
of this motion, moved by Honorable Shuaibu. Honorable Shuaibu has spoken. Honorable Mohammed Sani Zoro will now take turn to
Chris.
Argue
to your seat,
part
please.
Of the motion. So, Honorable Shuaibu, please.
Rahman Shuaibu in Mubi North, Mubi South, Federal Constituency. I'm from Adamawa State. The motion is on the need for the government to take immediate action on the reported malnutrition and death in the internally displaced persons in Burma and other areas from insurgents. The House notes that it was reported by Doctors Without Borders that three children died at IDP camp in Burma, Borno State. Also, UNICEF said 244,000 children are found to be suffering from malnutrition in Borno. Almost one in five, or roughly 49,000, will die if they fail to get quick medical assistance. Manuel Pontier, UNICEF Regional Director for Western and Central Africa, said 134 children on average will die every year from causes linked to malnutrition if the response is not scaled up quickly. This ugly news was widely reported in different media. One now begins to wonder the number of children that must have died. Could there not be in hundreds or thousands? I pose this as a rhetoric question. The president is also worried. One can feel his anger, knowing the federal government has channeled billions of naira for the care of the bases and victims of terrorism across the country. Where has the money gone to? Has the fund developed wings and flew away? Has made it impossible to feed the children in displaced persons camp Borno State and other areas. Worried that if nothing is done, hunger will continue to ravage children in camps all over the Federation and in Burma, Borno State in particular, and more children will pass away. It's a known fact that hunger subjects children to malnutrition and then death. Where that these children are the leaders of in them we have the future National Assembly members of industry, and leaders of problem solvers and problems. Further, that federal state governments and foreign donor agencies have donated money for the care of the victims of Boko Haram. That is also the victim support fund. That all these funds put together, if judiciously used, have provided sufficient food for these children, parents, or guardians. I have to resolve to urge the federal government to, as a matter of urgency, buy sufficient food to the IDPs across the country. Then, two, mandate committee on IDPs, refugees, and initiatives of Northeast. investigate the utilization of funds allocated for the IDPs and activities of NGOs at the IDP camps. I so move.
Out might have federal consequences of Adamawa State. Mr. Speaker, I wish to commend the mover of this motion. It's very timely and it has brought again to the fore the rot in the oil industry. Mr. Speaker, this contract was approval was granted by NAPIMS to Esso Exploration Oil and Production Nigeria Limited, a subsidiary of ExxonMobil, to award four single source contracts at a total of $260 million. This contract did not go through the normal bidding process, no tendering was done, and no approval from even the NNPC itself. Mr. Speaker, the contract was also awarded via three memos with the same reference number. Mr. Speaker, it is very important that we investigate and find out, because some Britons were also arrested who were illegally employed by the company, because the company that was awarded this contract did not have the capacity to carry out the job. So, and it was, the contract was also, it was a contract given to another company that was taken and given to, awarded illegally to another company which did not have the capacity to do the job. So, Mr. Speaker, it is very important that we look at this, investigate, and come, because since it's an investigative issue, we should not come to conclusion. So we should allow those concerned to investigate, because the Britons were also arrested by the Nigeria Immigration Service for coming into Nigeria illegally. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is my little contribution. I rise, Mr. Speaker, to support this very important motion. The issue of security, Mr. Speaker, is very, very important, and we have to take it with all seriousness. It's not only the number of personnel, we also have to look at the equipment, the logistics, and every other things that are related to the security of this country. Mr. Speaker, 90,000 is not a small number. We are talking of employing 10,000. 10,000 is not even replacing one-tenth of what we have already lost. So, Mr. Speaker, we have to investigate, know the number that have been lost, replace, and then employ new ones so that we can be able to meet up with the global acceptance media. Mr. Speaker, if you are in trouble in this country, that's when you will know that there is no security. Aftermath of 2011 presidential election, Mr. Speaker, in my local government, we were in serious trouble because there were no policemen. Anytime you call, they will tell you they are coming, but they are not even available to come. So, Mr. Speaker, we have to take this issue very seriously. We have to investigate seriously, not only, as I said earlier, not only the number of policemen, but also the logistics available to the policemen. And actual funding, Mr. Speaker, even if they have vehicles, how do they fund these vehicles?
How do they foil them? How do they pay the allowances of their staff? All these things have to be budgeted for, and we have to look at them seriously. Mr. Speaker, I call on our honorable colleagues to support this motion as a very, very important and timely motion. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.